Why do you seem so scared? All I wanted to do was play with you. Please come and play with me. I'm so lonely. You're not afraid of the dark, are you? Don't be afraid. Come with me. I will show you where I play hide and seek. Do you want to play hide and seek? You hide, and I'll find you.
Hello, welcome to Human Monsters. I'm going to introduce this episode with an excerpt from my interview with Dee Simon, host of the podcast Sick and Wrong. If you not only like true crime, but also stories about individuals who are truly deranged and at variance with society, I highly recommend you check out that show. Without further ado, this is Dee Simon giving you a quick primer on Ed Gein. Who's your favorite serial killer and why?
Who is my favorite serial killer? I've always been fond of Ed Gein. Mm-hmm. I've always been fond of Ed Gein because it's just such a horrific story. And it's been such an inspiration to so many like movies. You know, you had like Silence of the Lambs, you had Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but like truly a house of horror. I mean, it's Psycho. Psycho is based on Ed Gein too.
Yeah.
You really hear stories that are, you know, or serial killer crimes that are at that level. I mean, there are more prolific serial killers. I mean, Ted Bundy killed more people than Ed Gein. Jeffrey Dahmer killed more people. Jeffrey Dahmer is probably my close second. Because Dahmer, yeah. God, that entire story with Dahmer is insane. But, you know, Dahmer and Ed Gein are both from Wisconsin.
Yeah.
What's interesting about Ed, we actually have never done like an intro on Ed Gein on the show. That was one thing I always wanted to do, was kind of like focus on serial killers, but Wackerly thought that was boring, so we never really did that. And then Harrison doesn't want to do it now because there's all those million other true crime podcasts out there now that do it, like, I don't know, like Last Podcast, Let's, and all that, and they've done like a 3-episode thing on Ed Gein. So I've kind of, we usually go like the more, even more obscure serial killers, like Joe Ball, the Alligator Man. We did that recently. But Ed Gein is a fascinating guy. Like, this guy, you know, was much like Anthony Perkins in Psycho. You know, his mother just completely controlled him. His mother made him dress like a woman. His mother, even at the end when she was dying, he still slept next to her corpse. And I think that's all part of it that made his twisted psyche. And then, you know, then he started like kidnapping women and making furniture out of their skin. Just a crazy man.
Yeah.
And just inspired like Texas Chainsaw and all that. So Ed Gein definitely is probably one of my, I'm fascinated by that guy.
This is a quote from Stevens Point's Daily Journal, November 25th, 1957. Edward Gein had two faces. One he showed to the neighbors, the other he showed only to the dead. To understand Ed Gein, it is vital to understand the parental dynamic in his childhood home. His father was dominated by his mother. She was a tyrannical and fanatically religious woman. She was outraged by the morality of the modern world. She clung to her old world values with zealotry. The way she saw it, life was to be taken seriously. It should be approached with hard work, thrift, and asceticism. As a mother, she was the disciplinarian. She was self-righteous, domineering, and non-negotiable. She considered her beliefs to be the truth and law. They were impervious to logic. Her husband, George, deferred to her. It was the only kind of marriage that would work for such a woman. Augusta's personality was consolidated after they married. She was harsh, rigid, and intolerant of any challenge to her creed and way of life. She considered George to be weak, calling him a lazy dog, among other things. He didn't enjoy work, much to her chagrin. She was also infuriated that when he did work, he spent his earnings at the taverns. She was the strongest member of the household in every way. She never had a kind word to say to him, and he never spoke to her unless spoken to. He did stand up for himself when he was drunk. He would hit her, and she would drop to the floor, crying and shouting insults at him. She would then pray for his early demise. She saw sex as being purely for the purpose of procreation. That was the only reason she would have George in her bed. She wanted children, so she let George sweat over her when required. The first child was born on January 17, 1902. His name was Henry. Augusta didn't feel close to Henry. She had wanted a girl, and her disappointment nullified any possibility of bonding to the child. She clenched her teeth once again and allowed George to pry her open and deposit his demon seed in her once more. She prayed every night that she would give birth to a girl. Her second child was born on October 27th, 1906, in La Crosse, Wisconsin. Another boy. He was named Edward Theodore. When Augusta was informed the baby was a boy, she became embittered. She even felt betrayed by God. She would make the most of the situation. She grabbed Edward when he was still a newborn and made a vow to herself. She was determined that Edward would not grow up to be like the rest of his gender. She saw men as lustful, sweaty, and profane, filthy creatures who wanted to infect women's bodies with their filth. No, this one would be different. She would do everything in her power to ensure he would be molded to her stringent specifications. Many years later, Ed Gein would be asked about his mother over and over. His eyes would well up with tears, and his throat would swell to the point that he would have trouble swallowing. He would describe her as pure goodness. She had suffered so much throughout her life. She devoted her life to saving him from the evils of the world. He tried to live up to the unrealistic example she expected of him. It was impossible. Nobody could live up to that standard, and it was an endeavor at which he often failed. He recalled a story from his childhood. His mother gave him a few coins to buy bread from a bakery. By the time he arrived at the bakery, the coins had disappeared. He wept as he anticipated her possible reaction. When he told her he lost them, she looked down at him with eyes that were saturated with bitterness and sorrow. Her disappointment in him was a bottomless pit. She said, "Finally, you dreadful child." He had broken her heart, or at least that was conveyed by the inflection of her voice. She concluded by saying, "Only a mother could love you." She considered herself as personifying the ideal of human perfection on every level. She would persecute him for his imperfections throughout his childhood. He felt it was sacrilege to even consider that she possessed flaws. To quote Ed, she was like nobody else in the world. One significant event from his childhood that involved his mother occurred when he was a toddler. He was falling down a flight of stairs in their home. He recalled that he was pushed. His mother grabbed his arm and saved him. She was angry at him for falling, and he would rely on her for the rest of her life to save him from any variety of danger. There was a slaughterhouse in back of their home. Ed was forbidden from entering it. But since children are often attracted to taboos, like a moth to a flame, he couldn't help himself, and he went in one day. His mother, with assistance of his father, was slaughtering a pig. He arrived just in time to watch her cut its stomach open and let its innards fall to the ground. Blood and slime was smeared all over her body. He would later develop a fascination with blood and gore. He would peruse horror magazines and true crime magazines. like they were a morbid form of pornography. In 1913, the Geins became farmers. Aside from the financial benefits, Augusta also saw it as an opportunity to put young Ed in a moral quarantine. In the country, he would be protected from the kind of unwholesome influences that one would encounter in an urban setting. They purchased a 195-acre farm in Plainfield, Wisconsin. Ed finished his formal education at the age of 16 when he graduated from grade 8. He was a mediocre student. Later in life, while under psychiatric evaluation, he was found to have a below average IQ. His only intellectual pursuit was reading. He read books and magazines in his free time. He didn't fare well socially among his peers. He wanted to fit in, but tried as he did to imitate their behavior. He was a true outsider, an interloper. When he did befriend a male peer, he would tell his mother, and she would be outraged. She would insist the boy had a bad reputation and came from a family of ill repute. All outsiders were viewed by her as the scum of the earth. She would scold Ed for behaving this way and become hysterical about it to the point where she would begin to scream at him. She couldn't believe he would be stupid enough to align himself with such malignant influences. His typical reaction was to cry and go to his room. The next day, he wouldn't even look at the boy who could have enriched his life with companionship outside of his relationship with his mother. Though there was nothing about Ed's behavior that struck his school peers as psychotic or homicidal, they did notice some peculiarities. His eyes shifted in all directions when he spoke to somebody. His omnipresent, lopsided grin, it remained regardless of the subject matter. It could be a man's deadly hunting accident or another man's heart attack. The grin remained. He would also laugh at strangely inappropriate moments, like he was privy to a joke of which only he was aware. The girls felt uncomfortable around him. Sometimes one of them would turn around and catch him staring at her so intensely that even if they were under 10 years old, she would still be left feeling unclean and violated. Despite this, if Ed happened to overhear a conversation about sex as a group of boys conversed, he would blush and back away. His peers noticed he didn't much like boys. In fact, he came across as effete. He was softly spoken, meek in posture, and his hands made nervous, fluttering motions when he spoke. It didn't help that he cried easily. He was hypersensitive and could not take a good-natured ribbing. They recalled an occasion when he was teased about his eye. There was a fat, fleshy growth on the corner of his left eyelid. It made his eyelid droop. One of the boys referred to it as his saggy, baggy eye. Ed cried in front of all of them. These experiences reinforced what his mother taught him about his peers and the outside world. The teasing, insensitivity, the dirty talk. She protected him at home, but in the outside world, he was vulnerable to this hostility. Hostility was not in short supply at home, though. Apart from his mother's moral outrage and religious hysteria, his father regularly beat his wife and children. He didn't work the fields much. He mostly devoted his time to drinking and loafing. Times were lean. Their crops only barely kept them fed. These were harsh conditions, and Ed retreated into a private fantasy life. He wasn't strong enough to contend with reality. As Ed inched closer to manhood, Augusta was harping obsessively about what she perceived as the wickedness of modern women. She had seen photos and illustrations from newspapers and magazines with the short skirts, cosmetic powders, and lipstick. She saw them as tainted and fallen. The women of the busiest nearby town, Plainfield, were said by her to be the worst of the lot. She would back this up with a passage from the Book of Revelations, which read, "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Growing up in Augusta's house, Ed had no reason to question or rebuke this citation. Other times, she would quote the following proverbs. The lips of a strange woman drop honey, and her mouth is smoother than oil, but her latter end is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Now, therefore, my sons, hearken unto me, and depart not from the words of my mouth. Remove thy way far from her, and come not nigh the door of her house. For why shouldest thou, my son, be ravished with a strange woman, and embrace the bosom of a stranger? What, my son? And what, O son of my womb? And what, O son of my vows? Give not thy strength unto women, nor thy ways to that which destroyeth kings. After the recitation of scripture, she would take each of her sons by the hand and make him swear to her to remain uncontaminated by women. She advised them that if their lusts became unmanageable and demanded release, committing the sin of onan, that being masturbation, was preferable to the immoral and unholy transgression of fornication. Henry did chafe against these expectations for a while in his teens. He made a few attempts to socialize and date some of his female peers. He proved to be inept at doing so. His mother was a burdensome influence on him. When she wasn't physically present, she was there in spirit. The angel on his shoulder drowned out the devil on the other with a megaphone. Finally, he resigned himself to the fact that bachelorhood was his fate. This was not unusual on Augusta's side of the family tree. She had brothers who never married. Now both of her sons would live without the company of the fairer sex due to the influence of their mother, who was anything but fair. If his father cast a shadow over Ed's development at all, it came to an end on April 1st, 1940. To quote Oscar Wilde, some cause happiness wherever they go, and some whenever they go. The Gein family did not miss George's drinking, laziness, and abuse. Though George's death brought some relief from the family's hardships, it didn't mark the end of them. Despite their ongoing efforts, their crops did not yield a profit. Ed's prospects as a labor force participant outside of the farm weren't promising either. His best chance at making something of himself was presented with the catalyst of World War II. He was eligible for the draft, but when he underwent the medical screening, he was rejected because of his drooping eyelid, which left his vision somewhat impaired. He was 36 years old by this point. Times were so lean, he took a number of odd jobs outside of the farm to contribute to the family's resources. Much of this work involved errands as a handyman, such as installing windows, patching roofs, painting houses, repairing fences, and so on. He also did some babysitting. The children enjoyed his company. He would roughhouse with the boys and do silly magic tricks for the girls. He also told them creepy stories about headhunters and cannibals from the adventure magazines he read. He felt comfortable with children. Adults were another story. He was always self-conscious and insecure with adults, especially women. The only adult close to his age that he felt comfortable with was his brother. One thing they didn't agree on was their mother. Henry felt uneasy about the hold she had on Ed's psyche. He also didn't share Ed's view that she was eligible for sainthood. Ed was shocked by this and found it incomprehensible. Ed never questioned Augusta's propaganda. Henry died on May 16, 1944. His death was treated as suspicious, though the cause has been disputed. Ed lit what was intended to be a controlled fire to burn off some dead grass. The fire got out of control, and Henry was immolated. That's Ed's side of the story. It was suspicious because when he led a search party to where Henry lay, Henry's clothing was found to be marked by soot, but he was not burned. Even more suspicious was the presence of bruises on his head. Though he found it easy to take them there at that point in time, Ed told them he couldn't find him before. When they pointed out this discrepancy to him, he said, "Funny how that works." The coroner ruled that Henry died from asphyxiation and did not consider foul play to be a factor. The suspicion that Ed was responsible for Henry's death never subsided. Comparisons to Cain and Abel were made in Plainfield. It's the kind of small, close-knit community where so little happens that nobody forgets a thing. It wasn't the first time that a farmer in the area died from dealing with a brush fire, and Henry did have a heart condition, but there were odd things about Ed's reaction to Henry's death. He seemed to feel nothing. Now, Augusta had Ed to herself. He wouldn't have long to savor that turn of events. Soon after Henry died, she complained of feeling lightheaded and sickly. The symptoms worsened to the point where medical intervention was required. Ed drove her to a hospital. She was so weak by then, she had to be transported to the examination room in a wheelchair. As she was being assessed, Ed waited outside, tormented by anxiety. His long wait ended when a doctor informed him his mother had a stroke. Ed remained faithfully at her bedside every day. He was present during every second of the allowed visiting hours. When she was discharged, she was still weak. He had to carry her into their house and lay her in bed. He was disturbed by how weak and frail she was. She was an entirely different person from the mother he knew. Oddly, he felt exhilarated by the fact that she was helpless. She depended on him because she could not care for herself. He was riveted by the opportunity to please her at her hour of need. He fantasized about the physical affection he might receive from her as part of her gratitude. He waited on her day and night. He never complained about what he had to do for her, in addition to all his chores. At night, he would sit by her bed and read to her by lamplight. Not even a stroke could keep Augusta down for long. By mid-1945, she was ready to try walking again and was determined to be independently mobile. Eddie offered her his assistance, but she rejected it harshly, saying, "Move away, boy, I can manage myself." Though he was happy to see that she was recovering, her lack of gratitude for what he had done for her was heartbreaking. More heartbreaking was Augusta's second stroke. Ed rushed her to the hospital, but this time there was no opportunity to recover. She died on December 29, 1945, at the age of 67. It was fittingly symbolic of Augusta's legacy as a human being that only Ed and a few of his aunts and uncles attended her funeral. Nobody was grieving to the same degree as Ed. He was crying hysterically, his face smeared with tears and mucus. Her death was too traumatic for him to practice any amount of self-restraint for any reason. It was the worst tragedy of his life. His mother had been his only friend and only true love, his closest relationship. As 1945 gave way to 1946, he brought in the new year alone. The rest of the country was still celebrating their victory over the Nazis and awaiting better days ahead. Conversely, a dark shroud swept over the life of Edward Gein. After the worst of Ed's grief passed, life went on, and his neighbors remembered him as being his same eccentric self. The only noticeable difference was in his grooming and hygiene. He was often disheveled and unshaven. He didn't bathe as regularly, and many were repulsed by his body odor. Maybe it wasn't just his body odor. Ed dug up his mother's corpse at some point and slept in bed with it. She may have gotten a little ripe after a while. The Gein farm was also markedly different. He discontinued his farming chores, allowing weeds to grow up in the field. He sold the livestock to pay for his mother's funeral. Farm equipment turned to rust. To make ends meet, Ed leased a few acres of his land to his neighbor's farms and continued to do odd jobs. He even worked for the municipal government for a while, doing maintenance work like clearing brush and plowing snow in the winter. One added bonus was that he was eligible for a farm subsidy. Since the soil was long neglected, it was part of a state soil conservation program. He never did get around to using the money for its intended purpose. He did work on other farms for pay on occasion. The work crews remembered him as being hardworking, dependable, and well-mannered. They didn't always treat him well, though. They would subject him to practical jokes, and he experienced humiliation reminiscent of what he went through in school. Ironically, he is remembered for being squeamish about blood. Though he often hunted rabbits and squirrels, he couldn't bring himself to kill a deer. Seeing a deer dressed out was too much for him. This man, who was obsessed with the gore of horror and true crime magazines, and who also grew up watching animals being slaughtered and butchered, couldn't deal with seeing a deer stripped of all of its hide and its inner flesh exposed. Curious, since he always delighted in recounting some juicy murder he read about in a magazine, like Inside Crime or Startling Detective, he loved talking about murder. He only talked about sex in the company of men. He wasn't in the company of men very often. Then again, his social activity was winding down. He was retreating from society, reality, and in the process, sanity. He had an endless surplus of free time on his hands as he sat in his decaying farmhouse. He mostly just left the house to run errands or do an odd job. The only place he visited with regularity was Mary Hogan's Tavern. He was never much of a drinker. His father's example ensured he would never allow himself to become an alcoholic. His mother didn't look favorably upon liquor, so when he went to the tavern, he didn't drink much. The real reason he went there was the proprietor, Mary Hogan, was middle-aged, weighed almost 200 pounds, had a thick German accent, and at least in Ed's point of view, she resembled his mother in disposition and profile. His fascination was also piqued by the ways in which they differed. Augusta was strong, but Mary Hogan was tough, with a potty mouth and a shady past. She was rumored to have ties to the mafia and to have once been the madam of a brothel. He saw her as the demonic flip side of his mother. He was baffled that God would let his mother perish while keeping Mary Hogan alive. He was sure this injustice was in want of correction. In his mid-40s, Ed Gein lived in a house that had become more dilapidated and squalid over the years. It was overrun by vermin, like mice. There were cobwebs in the ceilings and rafters. The rodents and spiders were his only roommates. There was garbage all over the place. Who needs curtains when a translucent layer of grime will conceal your private life from the prying eyes of outsiders? The house came to resemble the haunted houses of B-grade horror movies. He ate pork and beans every night for dinner. He didn't cook it with a pot. He merely opened the can and put it right on a burner. The house wasn't heated during the cold weather months, and he typically wore his jacket indoors. Before eating the beans, he would remove the wad of Wrigley's chewing gum from his mouth and add it to his collection, which he stored in a 1-pound coffee can. He put the coffee can on a shelf where it sat alongside some of his dust-covered possessions. A gas mask, some used medicine bottles, three old radios, which worked but in a limited capacity since there was no electricity in the house. No plumbing either, for that matter. There was a box full of plastic whistles, toy airplanes, breakfast cereal premiums, a sponge rubber ball that was decomposing, two sets of yellow dentures, a wash basin filled with sand, handmade bowls he molded himself. Ed Gein was quite the collector. He would stick a finger in the beans to test them for sufficient warmth. When satisfied, he would empty them into one of the bowls. He would take one of the unwashed utensils from the sink and produce a spoon. He would take the bowl with a spoon and an oil lamp and leave the kitchen. The floor was blanketed with garbage and other filth, food scraps, rodent shit, grimy rags, empty food cans, oatmeal containers, cardboard boxes stuffed with crime magazines, a half-empty sack of plaster. It is so dark at night, he's lucky if he doesn't trip on any of these obstacles. He doesn't own a telephone. He would go to his room. It had its own chimney. Occasionally a squirrel would come into his room through the chimney. His bedroom was even more foul than the kitchen. Discarded food cans, empty cartons, crumpled newspapers, old musical instruments unplayable due to disuse and disrepair, a 3-foot stack of tattered coveralls, a clothesline hung with soiled handkerchiefs hung above his bed. The items that have received maintenance and care are his guns, two 22 caliber rifles, a 22 pistol, a 7.65mm Mauser, and a 12-gauge shotgun. His bedroom's two windows have been shut with tar paper. He will eat beans on his grease-stained mattress as he reads true crime magazines and books. He was fascinated by the tortures the Nazis visited upon the inmates of the concentration camps. He was especially taken with the story of Ilse Koch, the so-called bitch of Buchenwald, who was accused of collecting human heads and using the tattooed skin of their victims to make lampshades and book bindings. He got a kick out of reading about Irma Grisa, an SS warder who horsewhipped women and children after selecting them for execution. It wasn't just lurid tales of killing and torture that caught his interest. One story that captured his imagination involved a former American soldier from New York City who traveled to Denmark and underwent a sex change operation. Ed was deeply affected by this story because since his childhood, he frequently daydreamed about becoming a girl. He would fantasize about having a vagina. He only got to see realistic images of vaginas in medical textbooks. If he was unable to find a magazine article about cannibalism, grave robbing, Nazi war crimes, or sexual mutilation, he would seek reading material elsewhere. He would look to local papers in search of stories about murders, car accidents, suicides, and unexplained disappearances. He was hooked. He also loved reading the obituaries. He would tear out and save his favorites. After eating the beans, he would drop the reading material to the floor. He might feel lonely and pine for the presence of his mother. He was convinced he heard her presence since she died, heard her voice, telling him to be good, exactly the kind of thing she would say. What made him feel even more alone was the way his neighbors treated him sometimes. His kindness and assistance was often repaid with cruelty and deceit. They made fun of him, cheated him out of money he rightfully earned, borrowed equipment from him and didn't give it back, A few local women invited him in for a meal and sometimes even to watch TV with their families. For the most part, he was without friends and alone with feelings of bitterness toward his fellow man and yearning for the presence of his mother. He considered selling the property. He considered moving as far away from Plainfield as possible, maybe even to another country. He could never summon the energy or will to do so. Ever since his mother died, he felt like he was living in a bad dream, only he woke up to it instead of abandoning it upon waking, which made it harder to take. Sometimes he was haunted by paranoid delusions. Once, while he was squirrel hunting on his property, he looked up and locked eyes with a buzzard. It seemed to be glaring at him. It was personal. Another day, he was walking through a field when he happened to look down at a pile of yellowed leaves. He saw human faces peeking up at him. They grinned malevolently. He turned and ran. He could hear them laughing at him mockingly. There was a miasma that rose from the ground and filled his nostrils with a nauseating stench. Due to his neglect of his farming duties, this element was likely the only one of the curses of his life whose origins can be traced to a carbon-based life form. He often lay still in bed, devoting all his concentration on visualizing his mother's face. That is, the face of her youth. It receded from his memory, and no matter how much he focused, he could not remember it. He could only envisage the way she looked in her coffin. It took him a long time to realize that he could not bring her back. He felt like his willpower was strong enough to summon her from the grave. Several evenings were spent at the Plainfield Cemetery, doing all he could to draw her back into the pink. One night, while contemplating this scenario, he was struck by an impulse that left his entire body trembling. His breathing was labored. He jumped up from his bed like a man half his age and rushed from the house. He had a craving that would not be denied. He got into his pickup truck and drove off. Mary Hogan went missing. A pool of blood was found on the floor of her tavern. Nobody knew where the rest of her was. They didn't know if she was still alive. Ed Gein occasionally worked for a farmer and sawmill owner named Elmo Uick. One day they were chatting when the subject of Mary Hogan's disappearance came up. It was a hot topic in the town at the time, and everybody chewed the fat about the possibility of what became of her remains. Sometimes Elmo would kid Ed about his ineptitude with women. At one point he said to Ed, "Eddie, if you had spent more time courting Mary, she'd be cooking for you instead of being missing." Elmo was perplexed by Ed's response. Elmo said Ed rolled his eyes and wiggled his nose like a dog, like as if sniffing a skunk. Then he smiled and said, "She's not missing. She's down at the house now." If anyone else had said it, Elmo might have been alarmed or suspicious. But Ed Gein was so reliably strange that he dismissed it as another of his strange musings. On those rare occasions when Ed left the house and socialized with other human beings, he would crack the same joke, possibly with another variation like, "She's at the farm right now," or, "I went and got her in my pickup truck and took her home." His audience would write it off as black humor and shake their heads with laughter, both amused and appalled. Ed Gein was odd but harmless. That was their estimation of him. What reason would they have for believing he killed somebody? Not even when Ed played a macabre version of show and tell with some of the local teenagers at his house did anybody suspect he was capable of homicide. More than one of the local teens reported being shown a shrunken head collection by Ed Gein. Gein told them they were from the Philippines, sent to him by a cousin who fought in World War II. The heads were authentic enough to creep these boys out. They had leathery skin, long matted hair, and hollow eye sockets. One boy was visiting with his brother at Ed Gein's house. Gein had a tool that could punch holes in leather and paper. While his brother played cards with Gein, this boy asked Gein if there was more paper to punch. Ed told him to check his bedroom. This boy recounts what he saw when he entered Gein's bedroom. When I went around the corner, there were three heads hanging on that door. Just the heads. The faces were dried and had hair on them. Remember those African movies with the shrunken heads? That's what they looked like. Not really shrunken. I'd have to say they were the actual size of the head. But skin, hair, all that. I didn't say nothing. When we walked home, I asked my brother what the heads could be, and he told me they were probably Halloween get-ups. And I was young enough that I believed it. I never asked Eddie about it, but from that particular time or shortly thereafter, Eddie no longer let my brother or me into the house. Rumors spread around town that he owned the heads, but everybody assumed the story about his cousin's soldier was true, so they just wrote his human head collection off as another of his eccentricities. The Gein house adopted a malevolent image and reputation among the town's children. A man named Roger recalled the effect the house had on him when he was a boy. If he had to pass the house, he would save his energy for the last 100 yards so he could run past it. To quote Roger, "It wasn't that I feared Eddie, I feared the house." Eleanor Adams found herself in the company of Ed Gein at his home. The 51-year-old wife and mother wasn't conscious of it, however. She was lying unconscious on his mattress. Ed hovered over her, delighted by the trophy he scored during his hunt. She reminded him of Augusta. He felt excited about having Eleanor there in his bed, but the excitement in no way resembled what he felt about his mother. He shivered with pleasure as he removed her clothes. There was no resistance. Her flesh was exposed. It had a waxy appearance. He grabbed his oil lamp and passed it over the length of her body. Part of the modern slang of that era had men referring to girls and women as dolls. That was how Ed perceived Eleanor Adams, a doll. He thought of how only little girls play with dolls. That made him smile. He stood by the foot of the bed. He spread her legs apart. He bent closer to get a better look at her. He was greeted by a foul odor. So foul, he recoiled. Mrs. Adams didn't move a muscle. He had laid out a selection of tools on a table nearby. Turning back to Mrs. Adams, he went to work. He was so excited to be doing what he was doing, his hands were trembling. He took a deep breath and proceeded at a more leisurely pace. He had no deadline, and the night was young. November 16th, 1957. Ed Gein drove to Warden's Hardware and Implements store. It was owned by Bernice Warden. She was generally highly regarded in the community, though she was also known to be snippy and sharp-tongued on occasion. She had once been featured on the local newspaper's front page as Citizen of the Week. She was 58 years old. Ed usually stopped by on Friday to have a look at the price of antifreeze. Lately, he had been hanging around the store more and more often, and his presence became a nuisance to Bernice. At variance with his classic reticence when it came to engaging with women, he invited her to accompany him to a roller skating rink in Hancock. Because of his ever-present smile, she interpreted his invitation as facetious, like it was born of sarcasm. Bernice was not amused. Still, she was polite to him since the Geins had been regular customers for years. He finally told her he was there to buy antifreeze. Moments after he bought the antifreeze and left, he returned. He told her he wanted to trade his Marlin rifle, which only fired 22 shots, for a rifle that could accommodate all three 22 calibers, short, long, and long rifle. He pointed to a Marlin on the store's gun rack and asked her if he could examine it. She said, "Sure, that's my favorite kind of rifle." She looked out the window, considering a local man's new car. Meanwhile, Ed reached into his overalls pocket for a 22 shell. He saw Bernice as a wicked woman who deserved divine punishment. the antithesis of his beloved and idealized mother. Locals were surprised later that day to find the door of the hardware store locked hours before closing time. Frank Warden brought his key to the hardware store and opened it up. He was concerned by the early closure, a rarity for Bernice. It didn't take him long to figure out that something was wrong. The cash register had been removed from the counter. There was blood on the floor. It was spattered as a trail that led to the back door. When he went to the back entrance, he found that the store's panel truck was missing. Frank was a deputy sheriff, had been for a year. He said to the chief deputy, Arnie Fritz, "He's done something to her," as soon as Fritz and another officer entered the store. Arnie asked him who he was referring to. Frank said, "Eddie Gein." Frank explained why he suspected Ed Gein of having committed the murder. "He's been hanging around here a lot lately, bothering my mother to go roller skating and dancing and to movie shows." An investigation was initiated involving several law enforcement officials from out of town. Ed had been visiting a friend and neighbor named Irene Hill. Her son was riveted about the excitement around the Warden murder and asked Ed to drive him downtown. Ed was warming up the truck when cops pulled up. Ed was known to be a semi-frequent guest to the Hill house. Traffic officer Dan Chase approached the truck and tapped on the driver's window. Ed rolled it down. Chase said, "I'd like to talk to you." Ed stepped out of the truck and followed Chase and another officer to their squad car. Ed got into the back seat with another officer. Chase sat up front. He turned to face Gein. Ed was smiling as always. Chase asked Ed how he spent the day, every detail from morning to the present. When Ed finished with his account, Chase asked him to run through the day's events one more time. This was to begin with his visit to Warden's. Gein repeated what he told Chase. Chase said, "Now, Eddie, you didn't tell the same story come through there that second time." Eddie said, "Somebody framed me."
"Framed you for what?"
"Well, Mrs. Warden."
"What about Mrs. Warden?"
"Well, she's dead, ain't she?"
"Dead? How do you know she's dead?"
"Well, I heard it."
"Where'd you hear it?"
"I heard them talking about it."
Chase was convinced of Gein's guilt right there and then.
Chase radioed the sheriff that they officially had the suspect in custody. He started the car and drove them out of the yard. The sheriff went with another cop to investigate the Gein house. While shining a flashlight throughout the house, the sheriff suddenly backed up against something. He turned around and found in his flashlight beam a large, pallid carcass hanging upside down by its feet. The front of the corpse had been split open. Its trunk was completely hollowed out. The head had been severed. The body was butchered like a heifer. It was an adult female's body. Bernice Warden's cadaver at your service. She was left there hanging like a side of beef. Indeed, this was McMurder, and Ed Gein had the tools to serve her upright. Performed like an expert butcher. He watched it growing up, and Mama didn't raise no fool. A wooden crossbar 3 feet long and covered with bark, sharpened on both ends, was shoved through the tendons of one of her ankles. The other foot had been slit above the heel and secured to the rod with a thick cord. Her arms were held tightly at her side by hemp ropes that were tied from her wrists to the crossbar. The bar was hooked to a block and tackle and hauled up toward the roof beams. The sheriff was shocked and dumbfounded. All he managed to say was, "My God, there she is." He ran outside and dropped to his knees in the snow. He puked his fucking guts out. Other officers, many experienced with grisly crime scenes, arrived and examined the scene indoors. They were appalled by the garbage and filth that covered the interior of the House of Horrors, like the shell of a rotten egg. But it wasn't spoiled food and assorted rubbish that disturbed them the most. That came next.
There was an odd-looking soup bowl sitting on the kitchen table. An officer picked it up and examined it closely. It had been sawed from the top of a human skull. It wasn't the only one. Skull caps were scattered all over the place. There were complete skulls as well. Two of them had been impaled on the bedposts of Ed's bed. Those were purely ornamental. Another item that looked out of the ordinary was a chair by the kitchen table. The officer who took notice of it had never seen a chair quite like it. He discovered that the woven upholstery was replaced by strips of human skin. The underside of the chair was lumpy with yellow fat. Human fat is yellow. There were four such chairs in total. The cops found more items in Ed Gein's house that were made of human skin. Lamp shades, bracelets, a waste basket, a tom-tom, the sheath of a hunting knife. They even found a belt made out of female nipples. A shade pole was decorated with a pair of women's lips. Waste not, want not. More on Ed Gein's human skin handicrafts after these messages.
For clearer skin, use Camay.
Camay, the soap of beautiful women.
Do shadows cloud your beauty?
Cloud your beauty.
Do shadows cloud your beauty?
Cloud your beauty.
Is your skin dull and drab? Is the beauty of your skin veiled in shadows?
Come out of the shadows into the light. Start with Camay. Start tonight. A lovelier skin with Camay.
Camay is so mild. It gives such rich, quick lather. Change to regular care. Use Camay, and a clearer, brighter skin is yours. Camay will take your skin out of the shadows and into the light of new loveliness. This lovely girl became a Camay bride. This is David Ford.
Camay helped make a thrilling difference in my skin. Try Camay and watch new beauty come your way.
What glamour, what allure. I love it. Painting, fussing, morning, noon, and night.
Me? Fuss with my face? Boring. I'm too busy. I want to look great without fussing.
With Laren, new Laren Cosmetics, I can. Face, lips, eyes, everything Laren goes on fresh, stays on fresh.
And pretty? You never look more alive. Even after five.
Look for new Laren Cosmetics at the Laren display. Put your face on and forget it.
Forget fussing? What would I do all day?
One day you realize you're not going to be 21 forever, yet you always want to look your best. That's the time many women discover a secret, oil of Olay. It's not greasy, yet it eases dryness by working with your skin's own natural fluids to help your skin stay softer and smoother, no matter what your age.
Oh, Cynthia, you look super.
Oil of Olay. It can help you look younger, too.
This is you, love. A glow with the dewy softness of face liquor, frosty blusher. Yardley's new way to put innocence on your face. It's a hint of color, a touch of frost, to shimmer, to soften, to light up your face. Yardley Face Liquor, the new innocence, the face he can't help but come back to.
Welcome back. A crime lab specialist picked up an old shoebox. When he removed the lid, he discovered Ed Gein's vagina collection, 9 vulvas in all. Most of them were dry and shriveled. One was daubed with silver paint and trimmed with a red ribbon. Another appeared to be the fresh product of the most recent kill. It included a portion of the mons veneris with a vagina and anus attached. The crime lab specialist looked closely at the fresh vagina and spotted small crystals on its surface. It had been sprinkled with salt. There was a box that contained 4 human noses. Nothing was left unchecked. In a Quaker Oats box, beneath that smiling Quaker on the front, were scraps of human head integument. This is the layer of skin, hair, nails, and other appendages used by the body to protect against injury and damage. Ed Gein had an eye for fashion, as indicated by these articles of clothing and accessories he made with human body parts. Several pairs of leggings made out of skin. a corset fashioned from the upper torso of a middle-aged woman. Ed took special care with this project. Very much the perfectionist, he skinned the top part of her body carefully, breasts included, and tanned it. He even attached a cord to it so that it could be fastened to his liking. Ed was also ready for Halloween. After all, he made several masks. They were the facial skins that were peeled from the skulls of 9 women. There were no eyes, only holes. The hair was still attached to the scalps. Some scalps were dried to the point that they appeared almost mummified. Some were better preserved, as if having been treated with a daily moisturizer regimen to prevent aging and clogged pores. A few of them still wore lipstick and looked lifelike. The victims were identified by their faces. 4 of the masks were stuffed with paper and hung on one of the walls of Ed's bedroom like hunting trophies. These were the so-called shrunken heads he showed to his teenage guests years ago. There were other masks. They were kept inside plastic or paper bags. A bag hidden beneath a horse hide was found to be containing a mass of dry hair attached to desiccated skin. The hair belonged to Mary Hogan. These masks inspired the movie character Leatherface of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. The cops investigated a boarded-off area the first floor. Unlike the rest of the house, the room they discovered was immaculate, clean, tidy. It was a jarring contrast compared with the rest of the house. The nature of the furniture and knick-knacks suggested it was a woman's room. It was very dusty, indicating the room had been in a state of disuse for many years. The cops continued to locate other macabre items in the rest of the house. They found other parts of Bernice Warden's body. Her heart was kept in a plastic bag on the stove. A pile of entrails, still warm, were wrapped in a newspaper and folded in an old suit of men's clothing. In a corner of the shed lay a stained and tattered mattress. The crime scene specialist lifted the top mattress by a corner and spotted an old burlap feed sack. It had been inserted between the two mattresses. Steam emanated from the sack. One of the men reached in and pulled out Bernice Warden's head. It was smeared with dirt. There was blood in both nostrils. Oddly, the expression on her face was tranquil. Gein took 2 10-penny nails, bent them into hooks, and connected them with a 2-foot length of twine. He stuck 1 nail in each ear. The head was to be hung in Gein's bedroom as a trophy or wall ornament. Back at the police department, the sheriff slammed Ed Gein against the wall and choked him. The other officers had to pull him off. Gein was not advised of his Miranda rights and was not notified that he was entitled to the presence and counsel of an attorney. The search of Gein's house continued. 6 more heads were found. Some were carefully wrapped in plastic bags. Others were tossed haphazardly under furniture. Monday morning, prosecuting attorney Earl Kylien released a statement to the media saying that Ed Gein confessed to killing Bernice Warden. The following is from Kylien's dialogue with Gein. Kylien: "Now, you start from the time you went into the Warden Implement store. Tell us exactly what happened the best you can recall." Gein: "When I went into Mrs. Warden's, I took a glass jug for permanent antifreeze. When I entered the hardware store, she came toward me and said, 'Do you want a gallon of antifreeze?' And I said, 'No, a half gallon.' She got out the antifreeze and pumped it out, and I held the jug for her to pour it in, and then she pumped out another quart, and I was still holding the jar while she pumped that. Then I paid her with a dollar bill. She gave me back 1 cent because it was 99 cents. This is what I can't remember from now on, because I don't know just what happened from now on, you see. She glanced out of the window towards the filling station across the street and said, 'They are checking deer there.' Then she looked towards the west, out of the west and north windows, and said, 'There are more people uptown than I thought there would be.' She might have said something about the opening of the season. She might have said that. Do you remember striking her or shooting her? No, this is what got me. Whether I took my antifreeze out, that is what I can't remember. It is hard for me to say from now on. My memory is a little vague, but I do remember dragging her across the floor. I remember loading her body in the truck. Then I drove the truck out on the East Road at the intersection where 51 and 73 separate east of Plainfield. I drove the truck up in the pine trees. Then I walked to town, got in my car, and drove it out there and loaded her body in the back of the car, and also the cash register. I loaded the cash register in the truck when I put her body in there. Then I drove out to my farm and took the body out of the car and hung it up by the heels in my woodshed. Tell me how you took the blood out and buried it. You used the knife you made from the file to cut her up? That is as close as I can remember. I was a regular days-like, and I can't swear to it. Then you said that you took the blood from the body and put that out. Buried it out by the toilet house where he pointed out, east of the toilet. Do you remember what you had the blood in? Was it a pail, bucket, or jar? It must have been a pail. What kind of pail? Probably galvanized. Probably a 10-quart pail. Then you proceeded to dress out the body. You told me that you thought you were dressing out a deer. That is the only explanation I can think was in my mind. Kylene asked Gein if one of his intentions in butchering Bernice Warden was to eat her flesh. Gein could not recall if cannibalism was on the agenda that day. Gein told the police that Bernice was the only woman he killed. The other body parts came from people who were already dead. He was a grave robber. He said that for 5 years, starting in 1947, he visited cemeteries at night. Most of the time, he didn't bring anything home, but on 9 occasions, he dug up graves and opened the caskets. He would remove the parts he was looking for and then put the graves back in the ground. He would leave them, as he put it, in apple pie order. The bodies belonged to women who were recently killed, all middle-aged or older. Ed would read the obituaries and use the details as tips on where to find the freshest female corpses. He said he killed Bernice Warden while in a daze. Ed Gein was brought in for a bail hearing. He was to be arraigned, charged with armed robbery because of the money he stole from the hardware store. Days later, he was charged with first-degree murder. Bail was set at $10,000. Ed was taken back to his holding cell. Gein said he hadn't robbed a grave since 1954. He prayed for the strength to overcome his urges, and they finally subsided. He maintained that he never ate any of the flesh. Lieutenant Vern Weber said this of Ed Gein's disposition. He is a very sincere, very meek fellow. You would never believe he'd be the kind of guy to do such a thing. You feel like he needs help awful bad. This is a portion of Ed Gein's confession. Question, it seems like this item is from a leg, or probably from two. Is that sewed in two places? Ed Gein, that's from a person from the grave. What about the face masks? When I made those masks, you see, I stuffed them all out with paper so that they would dry. On the vagina, I did, you know, sprinkle a little salt. Was there a resemblance in some of these faces to that of your mother? I believe there was some. Do you have any recollection, Eddie, of taking any of those female parts, the vagina specifically, and holding it over your penis to cover the penis? I believe that's true. You recall doing that with the vaginas of the bodies of other women? That I believe I do remember. That's right. Would you ever put on a pair of women's panties over your body and then put some of these vaginas over your penis? That could be. Ed was cooperative and remembered as childlike. He was eager to please, answering any question they asked, He explained the methodology with the detachment of a scientist, however. He said he would test the freshness of a grave by inserting a metal rod into the soil. Once having dug up the casket, he would pull the cover open with a pry bar. Polygraph expert Joe Wilimowski questioned him further. Would you open the entire casket or just one of the halves? Just the half. And slip him out. That's right. Sometimes Gein would work on the corpse on a leisurely basis, taking his time. Other times he would cannibalize the body for parts and leave the rest in the grave. Wilimowski said, what section of the flesh would you remove? The head. The head? How about the vagina? Ed became a little flustered. Well, that. Not always. In removing the head, did you first cut through and then snap the bone? I guess that would be snapping. Would you work the head back and forth in the same fashion as you would when you attempt to break a piece of wire in two? That's a good description of it. I never took a saw to the cemetery. Ed explained the technique he used for collecting and preserving human faces and scalps. Wilimowski asked him, you just peeled the skin off the skull and disposed of the bone and other material that was in the head. Is that it? That's right. Wilimowski asked him if the skins were prepared in any particular way. Ed said, I probably put some oil on, that's all, to keep it soft, you know? Ed went into detail about the ways in which he put the face skins to use. The police speculated that they were hunting trophies or decorations. The truth was much worse. Wilimowski asked him if they were used as masks. Ed said, that I did. He fastened them to his head with a cord. Wilimowski said, would you wear the faces over a prolonged time? Ed said, not too long. I had other things to do. Ed also admitted to wearing the corset. He wore the leggings. He covered his penis with a preserved vulva. This was his idea of cross-dressing, similar to the character Buffalo Bill in the movie Silence of the Lambs, who was inspired by Gein. He was inspired by the idea to make bowls from human skulls when he read about the old Norwegian custom of drinking mead from the skulls of vanquished adversaries. He said he sprinkled salt on the vulvas to preserve them, though this preservation technique proved to be inaccurate, as one of them turned green. That was the vulva to which he applied silver paint. He hoped it would prevent further decay. He had soaked entire heads in brine, which had been effective. During this interview, Ed complained of feeling hungry. He was provided with a slice of apple pie with a piece of cheese on top. He was finicky and dissatisfied, complaining that the cheese was dry. This from the man who ate soup from human skulls. Ed was advised by his attorney to plead not guilty by reason of insanity. Ed agreed to take this course of action. Gein had a very hazy perspective on his crimes. He was about as disturbed by these offenses as he would have been about parking offenses. One thing that was unknown for quite some time was the motive. What would have motivated him to make furniture and fashions from human hides and bones? It turned out that Ed Gein had one hell of an eatable complex. His attachment to his mother was so strong, and the misandry she instilled in him was so great, he himself wanted to be a woman. He even considered a sex change operation, but never seriously pursued one. After visiting his mother's grave for a long time, he began to dig the graves of others. This didn't satisfy him for long. He killed Mary Hogan because she so closely resembled his mother. Ed Gein was formally charged with first-degree murder. To quote the charge's documentation, Edward Gein did on the 16th day of November 1957 at the village of Plainfield in said county, Washara, feloniously and with intent to kill, murder Bernice Warden, a human being, contrary to Section 940.01 of the Wisconsin Statutes, against the peace and dignity of the state of Wisconsin. His attorney entered his pleas for him, not guilty, and not guilty by reason of insanity. He waived a preliminary hearing. After accepting the pleas, the judge found probable cause that the crime had been committed. Gein was taken back to his cell. Having examined much of the media coverage of Ed Gein's crimes, fiction writer Marion Bloch was inspired to write the novel that would form the basis of a screenplay called Psycho. Ed Gein was brought in for another hearing. Prosecutor Kylene recommended that Gein be committed to the Central State Hospital for a sanity test before the trial. Referring to the condition of Bernice's remains, Kylene said to the judge, "I don't know whether a person in his right mind would do that sort of thing or not." The judge gave his consent to have Gein evaluated by mental health professionals. In the rest of Wisconsin, jokes and limericks were created with Ed Gein and his grisly crimes as the fodder. A few examples. Why won't anyone play cards with Ed Gein? He might come up with a good hand. What did Ed Gein say to the sheriff who arrested him? Have a heart. Why did they let Ed Gein out of jail on New Year's Eve? So he could dig up a date. One person went as far as to create a reworking of Clement Moore's A Visit from St. Nicholas. 'Twas the night before Christmas, when all through the shed, all creatures were stirring, even old Ed. The bodies were hung from the rafters above, while Eddie was searching for another new love. He went to Wautoma for a Plainfield deal, looking for love and also a meal. When what to his hungry eyes should appear but old Mary Hogan in her new red brassiere. Her eyes, how they twinkled, ever so gay. And her dimples, oh, how merry were they. Her cheeks were like roses when kissed by the sun, and she let out a scream at the sight of Ed's gun. Old Ed pulled the trigger and Mary fell dead. He took his old axe and cut off her head. He then took his hacksaw and cut her in two, one half for hamburger, the other for stew. And laying a hand aside of her heel, up to the rafters went his next meal. He sprang to his truck, to the graveyard he flew. The hours were short, and much work must he do. He looked for the grave where the fattest one laid, and started in digging with shovel and spade. He shoveled and shoveled and shoveled some more, till finally he reached the old coffin door. He took out a crowbar and pried open the box. He was not only clever, but sly as a fox. As he picked up the body and cut off her head, he could tell by the smell that the old girl was dead. He filled in the grave by the moonlight above, and once more old Ed had found a new love. He let out a yell as he drove out of sight. If I don't get caught, I'll be back tomorrow night. Police dug up graves from the cemetery Ed Gein plundered. They found that some bodies were missing while others were missing parts. He didn't confirm or deny that he meddled with any particular body. He denied that he ever engaged in necrophilia. He said it was monstrous to him because it was unhygienic. The corpses smelled so foul it was a turnoff to him. He had never engaged in any kind of sexual activity, save for masturbation. Augusta didn't exactly look fondly upon this practice. When Ed was 12 years old, she caught him masturbating in the bath. As a punishment, she grabbed his genitalia, squeezed it as hard as she could, and referred to them as the curse of a man. A garbage trench was dug up on Ed Gein's property, and more bones were found, including an intact human skeleton. Leathery hunks of human flesh were also found. Ed Gein underwent thorough physical and psychological testing at the state hospital. At one point during his physical examination, Gein complained that there was a putrid odor he was always smelling. When asked by a doctor what the stench smelled like, he said, "It smells like flesh." psychological evaluation revealed that Gein had a below average IQ. The overall picture sketched out a personality that was not that of a well person, but of one with insufficient ego, immaturity, conflict concerning identification, and possibly the presence of illogical thought processes. Personality tests revealed the following traits: a strong feminine identification, bizarre religious beliefs, a tendency to project the blame for evil on some other person, and a strikingly immature level of sexuality characterized by strong feelings of guilt. Though Gein was cooperative when divulging the relevant information of the case, he was noted to have talked, quote, freely in a low voice, frequently with his head in his hands. Occasionally he, quote, professed confusion, partial loss of memory, as well as trouble distinguishing between what he remembers and what he was told. December 18, 1958, Ed Gein admitted to a panel of doctors they often heard his mother's voice telling him to be good years after his death. He said he smelled decaying flesh in the surrounding environs of his property. He said he had seen faces in piles of leaves. The consensus of the doctors was a diagnosis as a, quote, schizophrenic reaction of the chronic undifferentiated type, because his judgment is so influenced by his envelopment in a world of fantasy, he is not considered to know the difference between right and wrong. His concept of the nature of his acts is markedly influenced by the existence of the delusional material concerned, in particular, with the idea that outside forces are responsible for what occurred. Because of his extreme suggestibility, he is not completely or fully capable of acting in his own behalf or in consultation with his attorney. This man, in the opinion of the staff, is legally insane and not competent to stand trial at this time. November 7th, 1968. A trial began and lasted 1 week. Granting a request by the defense, a jury was not present. He was ruled to be not guilty by reason of insanity and was committed to the Mendota Mental Health Institute, where he spent the rest of his life. His house was burned down and the property was sold. July 26, 1984. Ed Gein died of respiratory failure due to lung cancer. He was 77 years old. In the Serial Killer Hall of Fame, Ed Gein is a human monster first class. His body count wasn't high, but it was what he did with the bodies that made all the difference. I'm going to leave you with a song that was inspired by the criminal legacy of Ed Gein. It is Dead Skin Mask by Slayer. Thank you for listening to Human Monsters. Bye for now.